Okay, welcome to our 13th Reading Online Sport Economics Seminar. We're delighted this week to have Mario Lackner presenting work joined with Martin Haller and Alexander Ahammer from the University of Linz. But before we get to that, a few things to mention. First of all, I wanted to just remark on the events. So we last met last Friday for the last research seminar. Daniel Tokia spoke on community football clubs, FC United of Manchester. But then on Saturday, we had a very unfortunate event in the town of Reading, which touched many members of the department quite closely. There were three deaths and unfortunate incident that's now been described as a terrorist event in the town. So as you see, I've changed my background to somewhat reflect that. And so I wanted to just spend a moment just to mention that the event that took place, the regretful event that took place last week. But as I say, we're really pleased to be able to focus on a really topical paper this week. Some respects, it follows a paper that Brad Humphries presented a couple of weeks ago, looking at the effect of sports franchises in North America setting up and the effect on influenza. And we've got Mario presenting their paper this week that's been recently released in COVID Economics, the very quick publishing online journal for coronavirus-related academic research. And they're going to present paper titled Mass Gatherings Contributed to Early COVID-19 Spread, Evidence from US Sports. Mario, please do take it away from here.
Okay, so let me set up my slides. Do you see my slides?
Perfect.
Yeah, fine. Yeah, thank you very much for the kind introduction. It's actually a pleasure for me to be part of this really, really well organized and well programmed format. So obviously, what I'm going to present here is pretty new. Actually, some of the results are completely fresh. So you will be almost the first to see these results. What I'm going to present here, as you heard in the introduction, is somewhat closely related to an earlier paper from this format. You will see how and why. And what we try to answer is, how much did mass gatherings, especially indoor mass gatherings, contribute to the early spread and then later to deaths observed early in the pandemic in the COVID-19 crisis in the US? And we use evidence from US professional sports. So this is joint work with Alex Aham and Martin Haller, both from the University of Linz. And I will just start off now. So what's happening now? Okay. Yeah. Might take some time because I have some hefty graphs in there. So if it's slow in loading, don't be bothered. So what we are trying to ask is, what is the effect if we observe indoor mass events? And mass events, by the definitions that we have, really close to 20,000 attendees in the stands, on the observed and confirmed COVID-19 infection cases in the United States, and also the deaths associated with COVID-19. The type of mass event that we are focusing on are indoor sports events. And we have an average of attendees that's well beyond 10,000 attendees. So this would very much fall into the definition of a mass attendance event. So this pretty much is the perfect environment to study what we are after. So we observe indoor mass events from two leagues, basically, or from two sports leagues, professional sports leagues in the US. One is the National Basketball Association, NBA, and the other one is the National Hockey League, which is the biggest ice hockey league in the world, basically. Why is this relevant? Well, obviously, you have a clear policy measure in order to intervene when you, at very early stages, try to cancel mass events in the sports industry, in the sense that as soon as you are foreseeing or seeing the first indication of a pandemic, you could easily postpone or cancel all mass events in sports. And if you do this, you might be quite successful at comparable low cost. So if you have to do a nationwide shutdown, for example, or you have to close large branches in the economy, then this will lead to definitely much, much higher costs than if you just cancel a few games or part of the season or whatever you have in the end remaining, in this case, in the NBA or in the NHL. Our results in a nutshell, and again, these are a little bit different to what we have in our Corona economics paper. We find in the end that one additional game that we cover in our data increases the death rate, that is deaths per 1 million population observed in our counties, by 12 or 235 infection cases. After this short introduction, why we were interested in this timely question, one of the motivation is that we know actually quite little about how these mass gatherings do participate in spreading of epidemic. So when we look at papers that look at how mass gatherings of people contribute to the spread of the virus, then there's quite a recent paper out there which looks at spring break travel and finds that there is obviously the gathering of people, which is randomized on the basis when you travel to spring breaks, involved in how the pandemic spreads and how many deaths you will observe in the end. But we found that there is really few evidence really on indoor mass gatherings like the ones we observe in our data. And this is really what we are trying to answer here. So the literature has had quite a lot of attention on non-pharmaceutical interventions in general. So there was a lot of attention going to measures like shelter in place orders or other non-pharmaceutical interventions. I would call them NPIs. From now on. So there is some literature out there. Some evidence is coming from data on past pandemics from influenza diseases. So there are some observational studies out there who kind of show correlational evidence on how these NPIs contributed to reducing the spread of infections and deaths. But there is also some evidence out there that's trying to tackle the endogeneity problem there, because obviously the introduction of these non-pharmaceutical interventions is endogenous, because you will introduce them sooner or later, the higher you are affected as a region, state, or any other division. So we will see this later on when we look at our results, where we try to introduce some heterogeneity in results, where we also focus a little bit on how our results interact with something like shelter in place orders. So yeah, in your introduction, you already mentioned that a very interesting and timely paper was presented in this format by Brett Humphries and his co-authors, who used basically variation in when sport teams came to towns and used long-term panel data on influenza to estimate something very similar in the sense that it was obviously a different pandemics involved, but so it's closely related in the sense that some of these events are similar to those events that we are looking at. So. Okay. When I said that the costs of introducing, or basically what we are arguing, that the costs of canceling or moving parts of a professional sports season are very cheap compared what would happen otherwise, is underpinned by the fact that if you look at what NBIs usually are affecting the economy, there are estimates out there that if you have to close down schools, for example, that it would bear huge economic costs. Consumer spending obviously will go down. I mean, this is what we see all over the place right now, where people are just reluctant to spend. So estimates go up to 40%. And there is also a personal wealth loss associated with intervening in the spreading of pandemics. But there is also potential benefits that should be mentioned. So foremost, the benefits could be that you obviously avoid health costs, not only health costs in terms of real costs that you have to bear, but you could save lives, basically. And you could not only affect those that are affected by the pandemic, but you see other secondary health effects as well. So, for example, if you have a lockdown, as we have it had it with the COVID-19 pandemics, then you could also see, for example, that accidents go down, that certain heart diseases are affected by that because people have lower stress levels and stuff like that. But you could also see that some other health-related stuff goes up because people don't go to emergency rooms anymore, for example. Some people also estimate economic benefits, which obviously is driven by whether you are able actually to introduce NPIs that positively affect the pandemics. So if you are able to save the huge costs associated with having a high death toll and many, many cases in an area or state, then this could also be beneficial in terms of costs. And obviously, the shorter the shock is, the sooner the recovery will show up. And in the end, there could also be economic benefits. So my last bullet item here on the slide, banning sports events is relatively cheap compared to other measures. I will talk about that in my conclusions again, but a back of the envelope calculation will show that if you really are forced to, for example, close a whole season, cancel a whole season, then this would be comparably low cost to, for example, shutting down a country for multiple weeks or even months. So I was fairly quick on the literature review in order to save time for showing you what we contribute here. So yeah, this picture is basically the starting point from our idea that we had. It's showing the Dallas Maverick owner, Mark Cuban, on the evening of March 11, where he was attending a game of his franchise in Dallas. And he was basically reacting to the news that the NBA season will temporarily be canceled. So they shut down the season on the 11th. And what's special about this date is, I can already move on to the timeline, that on this date, they canceled two games, but on the next date, they basically announced that the whole NBA season will temporarily be halted. So I was almost witnessing this live when I watched one of these games the next morning as a stream. And there was a great amount of uncertainty to be felt here in the arena. And yeah, some of the attendees certainly left the building, and there was speculation live on air whether the game would be finished or not. So what did happen here, and what was the starting point of our idea? So last summer, the NHL and the NBA announced their schedules. So what they did in June and August was to announce their fixed schedule for all the games they would play in the upcoming season. So this is the point of time where our exogenous variation in the games that we are exploiting for analysis was predefined. Then in December, we heard of the first confirmed cases of COVID-19 symptoms in Wuhan, China. And yeah, by now we know that it has probably even spread sooner, as the virus is already traceable in November in Italy, for example. But this was really the first time this virus was mentioned in the media and described for the first time. And in February, we are basically able to define that the first confirmed victim in the US was recorded. So that was pretty early, actually. But then the whole pandemic kind of gained steam and grew larger and faster. And by the beginning of March, there was already speculation whether one should postpone or cancel mass events, which then culminated in March 11, where two NBA games were canceled shortly before they started. One involving the Utah Jazz, where one of the players right before the game tested positively for SARS-CoV-2, and the other one where one of the referees involved was working on a crew that was refereeing a Utah Jazz game days before. So on March 11, the situation was very unclear. There was a lot of uncertainty. Not that we know now that much more, but back then it was really completely uncertain what would happen. And on March 12, both leagues that are relevant for analysis shut down, basically. And for many weeks, there were no plans how to handle the situation and whether there would even be a season again. By the end of April, data fairly convincingly showed that the death statistics, the official death statistics from deaths associated with COVID-19 and also excess mortality in Europe, but also in the US, indicated that the pandemic would have a considerable death toll in Europe, but also especially in the US. And it's still growing with record case numbers just yesterday. So from this timeline onwards, we asked the question, how can we identify how these indoor mass events, namely NBA and NHL games, contributed to the early spread of COVID-19 and later on also deaths associated with this illness. And we collect data from the NBA and the NHL, from Basketball Reference. This is where we basically collected all the schedules and looked at games in February and March. We then assigned all the counties where the venues that we observe for all the teams in the United States and all the adjacent counties. So I will show you in a minute what we mean by this and how we defined our population of counties that we are looking at. The data on COVID-19 cases and deaths are collected from the New York Times data archive. So this is basically a growing thing in the sense that each day you would get the results for the previous day. So our data was growing day by day. And what they did also is that counties who had cases only later on in our observation period were then later later added to the data. So yeah, it also took some time until we finally had this data available. We have data on county characteristics, like population, temperature, geography, and stuff like that, collected from different, mostly governmental sources to have something to control for and check for potential heterogeneity of our population of counties that we look at. So, right. Yeah, everything is working. Okay, so these are descriptive statistics. We focus on the total number of games for both leagues, NBA and NHL, and have two types of counties. You will see in a minute on the map. The one type of county is the venue county, which is obviously the county where the NBA or NHL arena is located. And we have perimeter counties. These are the counties that are adjacent to these venue counties. And we took all counties that are geographically adjacent. There was one exclusion we made later on, but I will talk about this in a minute. We collected the data on the COVID-19 infections, or the cases, so to speak. And we have data starting from March 13, going to April 30. And we collect the same data for the COVID-19 deaths, or the deaths associated with this illness, for the same time period. We also collect information about the total county population. We calculate population density by using the land area of these counties and the total population numbers. By the way, that the total population numbers go back to the 2016 census, but we consider them still to be good enough to do this. We calculate population characteristics of our counties, namely the share of females in the population, the share of non-white population, and we also calculate the population which is older than 60 here. Later on in the analysis, we will use even more detailed control variables covering all these county characteristics. But as you see here in the descriptive statistics, nothing is really not well behaved here. The next thing we do is we look at whether our treatment variable, which is the number of games, which I showed you here, which is on average close to 4, is correlated with our county level characteristics. And once we introduce our state fixed effects, here it should actually say state fixed effects, sorry for the typo, but this is one of the changes we made. The only thing that is really correlated here is the share of elderly in the population, or 60 plus aged people, which we don't consider to be much of a problem because we control for it anyway, and it's really hard to make up a story why this should be some selection going on that is a threat to our identification strategy. So, to start off, our most important thing is obviously how did the two leagues fare up until this exogenous shock kicked in. So what we have here is, on the left side, you have the attendance for the NBA, and on the right side, you have the attendance for NHL games, starting in February 1 and ending at March 11, when we experienced our shock. So probably most of you are familiar with analysis of data from the NBA or NHL, especially from Basketball Reference, know that what they report as attendance data is not really how many people showed up at the venue, but only tickets distributed. So for a different paper, I show that these two numbers are highly correlated. So it's almost one by one for a season in the past that I get data on, but mostly these numbers are inflated, and we obviously would not see whether somebody bought a ticket, for example, at the end of February and was afraid to show up because already there were many news out there on the COVID-19 pandemics, which could potentially sweep to the US. So while we don't see any anticipation pattern here in terms of how many tickets were distributed, we would not be using attendance as our treatment variable because we do not really know how many people actually showed up there. So one funny side note, I also had tickets for the beginning of April for the NBA. Now that it's canceled, they said they will refund. I'm still waiting for that. So this graph perfectly describes what we are doing now, because I told you a lot about Venue and other counties. This is how we selected the population of all our counties we're using. In total, we use 242 counties located in 31 states in the US. And what we did is we defined those counties where the arenas are located, and we used all counties that are adjacent to this arena or venue counties. So it's nice to have this picture here because you can see all the clusters we are using in there. There are actually two changes to the results that we have in the COVID-19 economics paper version of our analysis. One change is that we now use this California county here next to Las Vegas. And the other change is that we don't use one New Jersey county, which I falsely assigned to be adjacent, although it clearly does not fall into this category. But still, it stays at 242. And you see these nice clusters that we use all over the US that gives us our analysis of 242 counties. One side note, we don't use New York City in our analysis for two reasons. We think that both are actually very good reasons. The one is that New York City is definitely an outlier in terms of how many cases and how many deaths you observe there related to COVID-19. And the second reason is that the data we have in order to control for county level characteristics does not match how the cases and deaths are reported for New York City. So you have all these factors aggregated and the county characteristics we do not have aggregated. So this is not a match in our data. And we decided that it would not be a good idea to use that anyway, because it would just inflate the effect we would find. Still, we are using the games in there for the adjacent counties. So no information is dropping from our analysis. So here's what we estimate. We estimate on the left side of our equation, the COVID-19 deaths measured on April 30, and regress this on the number of games that the observed county was affected or treated with. We use a set of county level characteristics to control for this heterogeneity of counties, and we use a state fixed effect here to control for a statewide unobserved heterogeneity in what kind of measures were introduced in these counties and stuff like that. So our control variables, as I said, is population density, different variables measuring the share of gender, ethnicity, and age groups. And we also, when we regress our deaths here, we also control for the number of cases on March 13. So we introduce our state fixed effect, which is also a minor change to the earlier version of our paper, where we use something we called affiliate state fixed effect, where we grouped a county that is adjacent to a venue county, but in a different state to the state where the venue is. Both things work almost equally well. You have an argument for this, you have an argument for there, for that, but in the end, we decided that the state fixed effect might be the cleaner and easier to interpret thing. We estimate robust standard errors in order to cope with potential heteroscedasticity. In the robustness check, we also show you state level clustering. So that much for our estimation strategy. Now we will look at the first results here. So first, I show you the results on COVID-19 cases that were observed. We have four different specifications. The first specification is simply the correlation between the cumulative number of games that were recorded in the county between March 1 and March 11. The second one is a model where we introduce our state fixed effects. The third model is where we start to introduce control variables. And the fourth model is where we have the control variables on an even finer level. And we see that we estimate a sizable and significant effect in our preferred model specification, which is specification 4, that one additional game in the cumulative number of games between March 1 and 11 increases the number of COVID-19 cases by almost 243. So this is it for cases. We decided to show cases as well, although we think that the number of COVID-19 cases is actually related to different aspects, heavily driven by how states or counties treated the pandemic in terms of how much they were testing, in terms of what was the testing strategy and stuff like that. What is really the core result of our analysis is the COVID-19 death rate, which means the number of deaths per 1 million population. And we do the same progression in terms of our model specification. And here now we estimate that one additional game in the cumulative number of games in our time window in March increases the death rate here by 13. So these are sizable results that are quite large. If you look at the mean death rate, which is in the table notes here, of almost 150, and it amounts to a percentage increase of almost 10% here. So at this point, we measure our outcome variable at one point in time, which is April 30. And since we had the data, basically the whole time series of COVID-19 cases and tests starting from March 12th, we regressed each day outcome starting from March 13 to April 30 and used it as an outcome variable in the specification I showed you before. And the results are presented here for cases. So you see that the effect is increasing over time that we estimate, and the April 30 estimate is presented right here. And we see that the effect is starting to pick up right around here, March 20-ish, something like that. So that's quite in line with what we would expect. So if people attend these games, the infection is spread because they are closely together in these arenas. They interact with each other. They hug, shake hands and stuff like that. And then after some time period, we have the incubation phase and cases start to pick up. On the left side here, we have the cumulative number of games for all counties combined. And you see that this number obviously is increasing over time as well. So now let's look at this result for COVID-19 deaths per 1 million population. The cases are also normed by population, but here it is again the death rate here. And we see kind of a similar pattern, although on a lower level, of course, in terms of the effect, where we see the effect pick up at the beginning of April, and then it starts to increase and kind of approaches these 14 additional deaths for an additional game in our observational period. So we try to make use of the heterogeneity of our counties. in the sense that we try to split our overall sample by characteristics that we think make sense in terms of how this pandemic might spread. So obviously population density might play a huge role. So there's always this discussion that the denser the population, the more vulnerable an area or a county is for a pandemic like the COVID-19 pandemic. And we split the sample in low and high population density counties along the median of the distribution of population density. And we estimate the effect mostly or exclusively here for high population density counties. It's only significant at the 10% level, but still this is kind of what we would expect here in the analysis. We also looked at the share of Black people in these counties by also, again, dividing our sample by the median of the share of Black people in these counties. We do not see a differentiated effect for these two samples. So what's been discussed in the media that it could be the case that the Black people population in the county could drive infection and death rates is not the case here for us. One thing that we speculated, if we believe the story that this is really about economic and social characteristics, that it is really more the low income population that's driving this anecdotal or tentative observation, then we would assume that these are not the people attending the games in the arenas, because they are obviously quite expensive also for single game tickets. We also split the sample by temperature. We collected data for basically as long as there are records on temperature, for temperature in April, used the last 20 years, calculated an average, and split the sample by the median. And we do actually see some evidence that our effect is driven by low temperature counties. This would fit the assumption that the temperature is associated how this virus spreads. Whether it's some county heterogeneity that we picked up there is a little bit unclear, but at least it's fitting to what we would expect. We also split it by using information about statewide shelter-in-place orders, where we also split the sample along how many days these orders were in place by April 30. And yeah, we see an effect for both samples here, which is hard to interpret in the sense that probably when you introduce such orders is highly endogenous. So that's it pretty much for the results already. What I'm going to show you now are some robustness checks we carried out. So the first robustness check was a jackknife type approach where we took the overall sample and then stepwise deleted certain states from our overall sample. So the states you have here on the x-axis here show you those states that were dropped from the sample when we regressed our model. What it shows here basically is that we get almost identical results when we drop here the states repeatedly. The only two outliers are New York, so our effect becomes smaller but still significant when we omit all New York counties. And we cannot precisely estimate our effect anymore when we drop California, which is not unexpected as we lose more than 10% of our sample, and with already a comparable low number of observation, this is not really that much of a surprise. But still the effect is exactly there where it was for the overall sample. So not too big of a concern. We also did this for cases, the same picture here. In this case, it's also we also see the effect again for California. If we drop California from our sample, And it's also significant and even higher here in this case. Same story again for New York, which indicates that New York obviously is highly affected by this pandemic. What we also did is test out different specifications. So what I forgot actually to mention is that we use population size weighting in our main estimates, which makes sense because you want to have those counties that are really large more prominently featured in your results. If we do not do this, our results stay the same in terms of the point estimates over our observation period here on the left side. The only thing is we lose some significance here at the end of our observation period, and the point estimate here in April 30 is only significant at the 10% level. But still, we are confident that we definitely should not omit population weighting here. The other thing we tried is cluster our standard error on state level. You know, we use this date fixed effects. We only have 31 states in our data, so we actually miss the recommended number of clusters, which is sometimes mentioned as 50. So we do have a quite comparable low number of clusters here. So this might not be the ideal approach. Still, the results stay almost the same. Another reason why we would not use cluster as our main specification is that we cluster our standard errors across states, and some states have only few observations. So there is really not too much to cluster the standard errors on for states like, for example, Arkansas or other states where we don't have counties, that many counties. Okay, so let's come to the conclusion. We use exogenous variation in the pre-scheduled indoor sports events in the NBA and NHL, and we estimate a considerable and significant effect on COVID-19 deaths per 1 million population in the counties we have in our data. We also observe this effect for the cases. In particular, we see that one additional game leads to 235 additional cases per 1 million population on April 30. So more than a month after our treatment ended, which amounts to 9% increase on the sample mean. We also estimate that we see 12 additional deaths per million population on April 30, which amounts to 10% increase of the death rate associated with COVID-19. So we see this considerable and large effect coming from these games. We test the robustness by using this jackknife type approach, and we see that while New York might be pushing the results in terms of effect size, it's not the single state that's driving our results in terms of what we get qualitatively. Our policy conclusion would be easy in the sense that at early stages of a pandemic, similar to the COVID-19 pandemic, it should be an early consideration to ban especially indoor mass events and shut them down as soon as possible, because as we see evidence, they are contributing to the early spread of the pandemic. In terms of what this means for the sports leagues, we have a calculation done for the NBA, which is based on numbers that are estimates provided by the franchises themselves, where you would see something around 100 million of losses for a complete cancellation in terms of the gate revenues and concessions. This would be something like the maximum damage. Could be higher, could be lower. It's just the back of the envelope calculation. But it's not necessarily the outcome that's most likely, because as it was in this case, the only thing that would have been cancelled would be March, April and the playoffs. So it would only be a partial cancellation of the season. So the potential outside options to this full damage case is a full cancellation, but having also the TV revenues taken away from the franchises or the leagues, which means that you would lose even more and probably much higher damages here. Partial cancellations depend on how many games you would have to cancel in order to be safe in the pandemic and avoid this effect that we are estimating. And moving the season would probably result in the lowest comparable cost for the NBA and the NHL, and one could do something comparable to what the German Bundesliga is doing for some weeks right now, where they almost get the full of their TV revenues, but no gate revenues. Complete economic shutdowns, as I've said before, cause significantly higher damages and costs, and sports leagues like the NBA or NHL, and now also the MLB, obviously, are likely to recover rather quickly if the economy recovers. So that's it for my part. Thanks for your attendance, and I'm open for any comments or questions. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much, Mario. There's been some discussion in the chat window, so I'll just try and summarize that. First question Carl had related to the when deaths occurred, when cases and deaths occurred, rather than when they're recorded to have occurred.
Yeah, that's a pretty good question in the sense that we don't really need to know when they actually occurred, because we are not focused on the deaths that occurred on April 30, for example, but we look at the cumulative deaths. So this is why it makes sense to kind of make the window a little bit longer. So we could have stopped, for example, at April 15, but we extended the window and looked at the outcome a bit later on, because we thought that tests that are recorded later and dated back in time might show up then in the results. So we see that the estimates are converging to a certain level. So we think that we have these kind of backdating effects covered in our analysis. Sorry, I can't hear you.
James, you're muted.
I've gone and muted myself. My apologies. Jack asks, have you considered including the cancellation of the NCAA basketball tournament as part of your analysis sample?
Actually, we have. It becomes pretty messy in the sense that obviously the number of venues goes up by a considerably large number, and it's not really the cancellation we are after, but really those games that actually took place that we estimate. So we are not worried about the tournament that was canceled. The only thing that could be an issue here is NCAA basketball games that actually took place. But that could be a thing that's worth looking into, yeah, definitely.
Okay, and then Brad had a query about an assumption you made regarding the attendances. So I think you mentioned about it being the tickets sold rather than the actual numbers that were in attendance. And Brad says, well, he figures that attendance seems important even if tickets sold are larger than the actual attendance.
Yeah. I mean, you can talk a long time about this attendance numbers. Obviously, they are not turnstile numbers, so it's not people showing up. And whenever you use this data, you can follow the assumption that they are vastly inflated. So when somebody report, whenever a team reports an attendance of 20,000, you could think of, it might be 16,000 that actually showed up. So there is some correlation. So I think it's highly correlated how many people actually show up. But this is the case for standard times. And I would not be able to make any assumption what happened in early March due to the COVID-19 pandemic. So there was so much uncertainty involved that you absolutely have no idea what's going on in terms of attendance. So it could be that in venues it stayed the same as it would be in normal times, but for other venues it could be completely different, that only half the people showed up that bought tickets. But yeah, would be nice to use attendance also as a treatment, but it's difficult to do this because it's highly endogenous, obviously.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, Mario. Related, Zach mentioned that you might be able to use SafeGraph data to see how many smartphones pass through a venue.
Yeah, that would be really nice to do this. I wouldn't know how to get this data, actually. But yeah, to have precise information, how much traffic was going on for all these venues would be tremendous. But
Zach's posted a link in the chat window. Can you see the chat window, Mario?
Right now I cannot. No.
Okay. Yeah. Well, you're sharing your screen, so you'll be able to look at it later on after the.
Yeah. Yeah. Event's sure. Finished. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for the link.
Brad also mentions that he agrees with mortality. I think you mentioned mortality rather than cases as a outcome variable. I don't know whether you're able to use mortality rather than cases.
Well, we're using the reported deaths. So we are not using excess mortality, which would be a nice measure to have. But I've searched for the excess mortality data on the county level, but so far I was not able to get hand on the data. There is data statewide, so that's available by the CGC, I think. But the only thing we can rely on is the reported deaths associated with COVID-19. And obviously that's gonna vary across states and counties, but yeah, it's certainly correlated with how many people are affected.
Great. And then Carl mentioned whether you might have had any kind of stadium capacity weighting in what you were doing.
One could do that. Yeah. That's a good idea. Kind of to weight how many people are there. What we do right now is to have population weighting. So we try to weight our results by how many people could potentially be treated, and that does change the results in the sense that they are slightly lower if we do this. So that's why we think we are actually doing the right thing there. But it's something we can take a look at, having the capacity there. But it's not varying that much. I mean, there is some variation there, but it's like plus 2,000, minus 2,000. So it's not that much variation.
Okay. And then Zach also asked whether you looked at any non-linearities in the effect of the number of games on cases and deaths.
We have not looked into that. We tried using some binary indicators as well, but I wouldn't be able to show you results on that. We could look at that. Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah.
Sorry, mute myself again. It's quite windy here, so I'm trying not to give any feedback from my microphones. Bernd asks a question, but he's also got his hand up. Bernd, did you want to ask the question yourself?
Oh, I'm happy to ask myself, yeah. Thanks, Mario, for this interesting presentation. Can you please go back to slide number 14?
Okay.
In the estimation, it seems that the number of confirmed COVID cases has no impact on the number of deaths. How can this be explained?
At least here in this specification, right?
Yeah,
in column 3. In column 4, it does have an effect.
Yeah.
I mean, it could be that some of the other variable is picking that up here, which it is not happening here in specification 4, where we use the full sex race age distribution. So it could be some collinearity involved in here that might explain that. Otherwise, it should obviously have a positive effect here, because it's doing some kind of weighting. How much was the initial, how large was the initial value where you start from? Although we have to say that the confirmed cases on March 13 are very, very low. So we have a large amount of zeros in there. So the number of cases was not really an issue at that point of time.
Okay, I've gone through all the questions in the chat window, and so if anybody else wants to unmute their microphones and ask questions, you're very welcome to. Well, in the absence of any questions, I'll just quickly check any questions via email. No questions via email, in which case I think it's probably a good point to wrap up and say thank you very much, Mario, for a really interesting presentation of your work. Really timely, really important, quite scary work in many respects, given the kind of implications of these kinds of gatherings. So thank you very much for that. As a wrap up, wish you all a fantastic weekend. And also just to flag that next Monday and Tuesday, it's a big week for sport economics. Next week, the North American Association of Sports Economists annual conference will take place, or virtual conference, next week, Monday and Tuesday. I presume Brad's here, so Brad can tell me, should someone that wants to attend contact you, Brad, or Victor Matheson? The conference will take place via Zoom on Monday and Tuesday. Brad says Victor. So Victor Matheson, North American Association of Sports Economists, if you want to attend. And then we will return next Friday for the Roses Talks. That'll be part of the East-West Football Economics Conference next Friday. A joint venture between the Higher School of Economics in Moscow, Paderborn University, of which Bernd Frick is a representative, and the University of Reading. And so we'll meet again this time next week. And the Roses Talk within that conference will be presented by Dmitry Degaev of the Higher School of Economics. But thank you very much, everyone, for your attendance, for your contributions. Thank you, Mario.
Thank you on my part. Thanks a lot.
And have a great weekend.